Okay, so first of all, we need to test shard. So that's the first thing. And for Cmyk, there are standard test shards, but there could be different kind of processes in the ceramics industry. There might be some very strange kind of color combinations for where there are no standard test shards. And for this situation, you would start with ColorAnt. It has a bunch of tools. Most of our tools look quite similar. On the left side, we have our sidebar, where you have a lot of different tools that can be used with the data that is loaded. And at the first step, we want to create a patch list with the required colors that we want to print for the fingerprinting of the Indigo press. So first of all, I go to custom chart and I define the color space I'm in. So for example, as I'm in a 7-color process, I want to create a test chart for, I select 7-color. And there are different kind of modes that you can select. We want to do profiling, so the first one is the right one. We have different modes as well for flexo. For example, if I select flexo, we give some indications what is different here. For example, in the flexo area, we have those bump curves in the light up areas, so we want to add some more patches here. There are as well other optimization things, like for example, if you have a profile and want to update that profile because the printing process deviates, you just need a little amount of patches. And for example, here, we just need 250 patches to update that profile. Whereas if you start with profiling, you have maybe, depending a little bit on the size of your media, if you want to have a great profile and you have a lots of space, you can start with 3,300 patches. If you have a little bit less space, 1,300 patches might work as well. And as a minimum, we would suggest for 7 colors, 900 patches to start with, to get a good characterization base on your printing process. So first that is defined, we have CMYK with an orange, green, violet. So it doesn't matter if that's really orange and green and violet here. You can change the colors if you need. So you can say that's orange, that's green, and that's violet, for example. And then you can define the amount of patches that you want. And if you have more space, for example, you could add up to 10,000 patches if need should be. So once you click on start, then those patches will be generated. And you have your list of patches. By double-clicking, a dialog opens up and it will show all the patches that are needed then for the profiling. Now you have that list. And basically you want to use that for a certain instrument. Therefore we have what we call the export chart feature, where you define, okay, I have an I1 IO, for example, I have a VRE instrument, a Tekton device, an Exact or whatever kind of instrument that we're supporting here. And for each instrument, there are specifics in terms of the patch width, the patch height, if there should be gaps used or not. Some devices have a ruler which defines the shard width in a certain way. Then your specifics on the media size where you want to place your test shard on are perhaps diverse. So for example, if I only have a height of 200 millimeters, then I need nine pages, basically. If I have more space to give, for example, 600 millimeters, then obviously I just need only 3 test shards with this kind of patch distribution. So that's how you can define your charts. You can randomize the patches or have a normal distribution, meaning the distribution coming from the patch lists, where it's more reasonable, let's say. And we would add the gaps if needed, and even patch numbers and so on. So to easily identify where the test charts are located can be done here. And if your design, let's say your layout has been fixed, then you click start and you would create your test chart. That could be either TIFF document or Photoshop PSD file or PDF document. PDF is obviously preferred because then all the patches are then defined as vector elements, making that chart much smaller than as a rastered element. So you can do that. And once that is done, so I just do it here. will define that. Once that is done, a reference file has been created. Perhaps we have to add a few patches there, for example, to make the line amount filled with patches. So it would look like here, like this one, where we have all the white patches, 18 white patches, to make that line filled with patches, basically, so that you can at the end measure that. And from that, you would go to your press, you would print that chart, and then you would measure it, meaning you would use the next tool here to measure the chart after printing, and then you would have real measurement data to start with. So that's the starting process for creating test charts for specific applications and sizes and measurement instruments. So I will clear the data here. Let's assume we have printed our chart, and I will now load my 7 color measurement data. We have a different kind of formats that we support here. That's CXF files, that's CGATS text file, XML files from different kind of vendor instruments. So we support a lot of different file formats here. I would like to load, for example, a CXF file with the Pantone Reflex Blue information that I had here at the beginning. And just to give you an idea, if you double click, it's the same as going to the view button here. Then we will open the charts, the measurement data that we've loaded. You have different kinds of visualization possibilities, a 3D view or TBI view, spider web and curves. And for example, in the curves view, there is a possibility to see that how the density looks like. And there's as well an ISO definition for spot color tone value increase curves. And if that would be perfectly aligned to that ISO form, then we would see a flat curve, a 45 degree curve here. So obviously it was close to this, but not perfect. And for all those kind of things where things are not perfect, we have tools to compensate for those things. So for example, somebody wants to have printed that Pantone Reflex Blue perfectly according to that ISO specification, but it obviously failed a little bit. Then we have tools like our tone value tool here that you can apply a correction according to that ISO curve. Yeah, so, and after, I just need to click here on start to make that kind of correction. And if we look again into our curve, then now my data is completely aligned to that ISO curve. And if I want to see which kind of corrections have been done, there's always a compare tool so that you can compare before and after the correction. So I need to load my original data here. So the remission data, and that's my corrected data. And here I can highlight all values that are higher than 2 delta E's, delta E2000 in this example, for example here. So my original color was a little bit too dense in accordance to that ISO standard. So we reduced the blue a little bit, as we can see here. So that gives us a delta E of 2, but it's now completely aligned with that ISO specification. So just to give you an idea on in a simple one color space, what kind of corrections can be applied. In our sample of the 7 color indigo, Cmyk, orange, green, violet, we have a full data set with Cmyk parts, with orange overprints, green overprints, and the blue and violet overprints. And here again, with the 3-dimensional view, we can see how that color space is looking like. For example, we can see, okay, let's have a look how just the CMYK looks like here. And here we can see how the orange expands on the orange area, the green in that area, and obviously the blue and violet in this dark blue-violet area. So we can see that this extended color gamut would printer would allow us to print many more spot colors, especially spot colors on that device, which wouldn't be possible in CMYK. So that's the reason for adding those extended colors for printing beyond CMYK. So we have our data here. We can have a look if we see some odd things here in our curves. Well, indeed, the magenta curves is not that really smooth. So that could lead to some issues, which we might look at a little bit more in depth. In the curves view, we can see that there are some duplicate patches. So for example, here there's an 80% black, which is which has two LAB values which are not completely aligned. We call this redundancies in the test chart. It's always good to have some redundancies to see some issues, let's say, in the data. These are only small issues here, but it can be as high as one patch has measured this one and the other patch had this one, and then which patch should the profile take for the calculation. So it's better to average this data. And therefore we have tools here which are in the editing space here. So we would correct redundancies. We would fix some really bad issues like wrong readings. And for example, wrong reading could be, there should be cyan, but you missed that patch and measured magenta instead. And then ColorAnt would see from the neighboring colors, oh, there should be cyan in there. And then it would calculate from the neighboring colors your interpolation, which would probably be the right colors, and would introduce or it would exchange that pub patch here to make the data correct. And after correction, you would apply smoothing. And we have a tool that it's called the automatic tool here, which would apply some corrections in the right order. In this example here, it would do exactly that. It would do a redundancies correction, then it would do be the fixing of errors, and then it would do some smoothing in the data just to see if our data is better with that. Looking into the TBI curves, we see our magenta curve is slightly nicer now. If I go back to how the curve looks in the original, so it jumps a little bit. So I'll keep it from jumping now by clicking on here. So that's my original magenta curve here, for example, and after correction and smoothing, you see the curves are much smoother, much nicer, and they will create a better profile at the end. Now, so that's how you typically would work. So that's a spider web view. Again, if I go back to the original data, you'll see some unevennesses here and there, which might introduce some issues at the end, and which are, by the way, a little bit questionable if that printer has really printed like that, or if it's just one chart that you have measured with some specific behaviors at that press, and perhaps the next print will be a little bit different, and therefore you want to smooth issues out of the measurement data before you go to the next step, profiling. So that's what we would do with the optimization of measurement data. So once we have that measurement data fixed, we could save this data out again into different kind of formats, like CGATS formats, which are typical for profiling application, text files, XML files, and so on. And we could use them then for the profiling. Before I will do that, just to give you an idea what the ColorAnt tool is capable of. So you probably have heard about those ideas that, especially in packaging, that there is a reprint of a certain package, and at a certain moment there was a reflex, there was a violet perhaps used, and the next time there should be a reflex blue printing, but else you want to use the same color, Cmyk, orange, green, you want to use the same things, but you just want to exchange the violet with the reflex blue. So typically it would mean you have to reprint again a full test chart on a press, a full press run with all this work that needs to be done. Nobody has time for that. It's cost a lot of time and money. Much easier would it be if I could use already some measurement data that I have made at another time on the same machine, perhaps on the same kind of paper, or best would be on the same kind of paper so that I have the characteristics of that device. And if I could use this measurement data and update and optimize my measurement data, find original measurement data to exchange my violet with the Pantone Reflex Blue. And that's a very nice functionality we have here in the Edit Primaries tool. We would select our violet here or our CMYK. You can use the pipette tool here and simply select from the another measurement data, in our example, our Pantone color, the other color, which is the blue. We could do a lot more here if we need. We can even change the printing sequence in here, but we don't need that at this point. We just want to exchange that color. And all the overprint information that we have in the original CMYK orange, green, violet would now be recalculated with the new reflex blue. So what we can see here, data where it came from, which with all the violet here, these are all the patches with violet in there, all kind of CMYK combinations, that some greens and some oranges as well in there, combined with the original violet. And all these colors are now recalculated, taking the overprint information, the spectral information into account, and the overprints are recalculated. So that would be a good possibility to save a lot of time, because now you have new measurement data with CMYK, orange, green, and blue. So we can see it here with the Pantone Reflex Blue. And now you could create a new profile and could use that profile in production later on with the exchanged ink without having to print a new test chart and all this burden of printing that and measuring and so on. So that's a very nice functionality which we have here inside the ColorAnt tool.